RadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
Good morning. Welcome to a Monday. I know it's a tough Monday morning for a lot of people because, you know, the Super Bowl ran somewhere around 35 minutes longer than it should have. Nicole Sandler here, RadioOrNot.com, SoFloRadio.com, TalkRadio1.com, and of course our new video stream via YouTube.com/NicoleSandler. Just click on feeds or feed. There's actually, if you log in to the website at RadioOrNot.com, under the Ustream window, there's a text link to the new YouTube video stream. Hopefully this will all be streamlined soon. Still working on it. Some things take longer than others. I like getting the lights back on to the Super Bowl. Yeah, you know, I'm not a big football fan. And hopefully by next year that will change, because I told you this a while ago that my father was a big football gambler, and he wrote a book 40 years ago now called How to Beat the Bookies at Pro Football. And I thought, you know, this book is just sitting here, and what if it works? You know, what if his system works? So back when he wrote it in the early 70s, yes, there were no personal computers, so he did everything by hand. But what I've done is teamed up with a friend of mine who is a big football fan and a closeted gambler. He and his buddies like to gamble on football, and he's got another very good friend who, for some reason, I need to get the whole backstory here. But his friend is basically in Africa somewhere, in a compound, I'm guessing like maybe State Department employee or something, I don't know, but and a computer whiz, and also a good, you know, a football freak and gambler. And so they want to team up and work on the book. So the friend in Africa is going to write the programs and then run a few seasons. And we will write an update of the book, and I will, you know, test it during next season and blog about it as it goes along. So by next year, by the Super Bowl next year, I will be actively involved. Now, I'm not going to bet because, number one, I don't have money to waste possibly lose. So I'll just, you know, do it on paper and see how it works. And hopefully if it works, then I'll sell a million copies of the book, and the following year I'll have money to wager. So anyway, I didn't care about the game last night. I really didn't. But I always enjoy the commercials, you know. Did you see any of the commercials? The Budweiser commercial with the baby, you know, Clydesdale, who then came, was just so wonderful. And the thing is, you can go online the next day and watch the commercials, which is what I did this morning. I didn't see any of them when they were live. GoDaddy once again showed that I will never, ever, ever use GoDaddy for anything. Their ads are just insulting. And Amy Poehler actually made me think, you know, maybe I'll shop at Best Buy because she's good. So that's it. But the best part of the game, I actually happened to be in the living room. You know, David was watching the game. And when the lights went out, yes, you know, if somebody didn't think that there might be a power problem in New Orleans, you know, when I heard they were doing it at the Superdome, I thought, ew, I wonder if there's still, like, you know, bodily fluids under seats and stuff. You know. Oh, now we just had a power surge here. Did you see that? That was creepy. All right. The power gods are pissed off. Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, that was weird. At least we still have power. Couldn't say that much for the Superdome for a good 35 minutes last night. So, of course, BuzzFeed put together a compilation of the best, the funniest tweets of the great Super Bowl blackout. I thought I would share some with you. Who knew the Illuminati had a Twitter account? But they do. At Illuminati, who tweeted, "We have nothing to do with this." Let's see. Dance to Damas. At Dances is the Twitter account. Damn light, still not on in New Orleans. Super Bowl. Obama doesn't care about black people. I should have a rim shot here, shouldn't I? Do I have a rim shot? I don't have one up. Oh, well. But I'm bumch. Anna Drezin tweeted, "There's only so many racist voodoo ads you can air before New Orleans strikes back." Mm-hmm. I like this one. Titanium Toplass tweeted, "In hindsight, maybe installing the clapper was a bad idea." Yeah, maybe. All right. Andy Levy, "Cory Booker, you going to fix this or what?" I like that one. Let's see. Rob Sheff said, "So it looks like the answer to 'Can you pay my bills?' was no." All right. I like this one from Mo Rocca. Figures from Mo Rocca. "In the cartoon Super Bowl, they just keep playing during the blackout and all you see are eyes." I love that one. Joe Randazzo tweeted, "Guys, I'm at the Super Bowl and this power outage is no joke. Most of us have broken into small but loyal factions. I am now a doctor." Yeah, I like that one. Attackerman just tweeted, "People of Gotham." Mm-hmm. Adam Pally tweeted, "It's a heist. Check the banks." I like that one. Neil Pollock said, "This time it's the rich people trapped in the Superdome." Mm-hmm. Maureen O'Connor tweeted, "Just plug a generator into Beyonce's hips. Problem solved." Dave Weigel made the list. Dave Weigel tweeted, "Luckily, the bar for worst power outage at the Superdome is set really high." Mm-hmm. Let's see. Probably Matt Honan, who must have been on Twitter very early because his Twitter handle is just @MAT. Good one. Matt wrote, "This tribute to the victims of Katrina is remarkably thought-provoking, even if I will admit to not getting it at first." Wow. Mind blown. That might be my favorite. Philip Bump, P-Bump, tweeted, "This is the same strategy San Francisco used to win the 1989 World Series." Okay. Now, Neil deGrasse Tyson, who is a famous, you know, like scientist kind of guy, had three tweets in a row. Pretty good here. Number one, "Not that anybody asked, but every adult human radiates about 100 watts in the infrared." Okay. Next one says, "Beyonce radiates about 500 watts is my guess. But to be certain, I'd have to run a special calculation just for her." And then the third tweet, ... for science. TVGM Damien tweeted, "Ugh, stop trying to make revolution happen, NBC." That's a bad, TV show on NBC. And then finally, the last on BuzzFeed's list of the funniest tweets of the great Super Bowl blackout from Gary He, at Gary H-E. "This would never have happened if the Superdome had a gun." Yeah, good stuff. Okay, so after the power surge, we're still here. We're still on all. And I got to tell you, it's funny that this happened because this morning, all of my my computer thing stuff here was all rebelling. So I think the power grid, I think it is the Illuminati. All right, here's what we'll do. Take a very, very quick break and come back on the other side with Jason Leopold. Yes, the intrepid reporter for truthout.org, who is now back. Well, he's always been on American soil, right? Even in Guantanamo Bay, it's still American soil. But he's now back on the mainland. Let's say that. Jason Leopold of truthout.org, back in California, from Guantanamo Bay, joins us next to tell us about his excellent adventure. I can't wait. And on purpose, I have not spoken to Jason Leopold since because you know, I want to learn all about it along with you. So stick around. Jason joins us next. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's radio or not.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Bradley Herring. Bill O'Reilly interviewed former Secretary of State Colin Powell about the Republican Party's focus on voter disenfranchisement. O'Reilly ignored key legal problems for voter ID laws under the Voting Rights Act. And he dismissed concerns of voter suppression, falsely claiming in-person voter fraud is a problem.
Surely you know how fraud is committed. And I mean, Boston and Chicago, you register and then you show up and it's not you.
I have not seen any study that says fraud is a problem of such significance that these kinds of procedures were in place. And I'm glad to see that Governor Scott in Florida has recently said he's turning this back over to his local community.
I just think showing an ID to vote is the bare minimum.
Multiple studies have shown that in-person voter fraud is virtually non-existent. Despite this fact, Republican state legislators and their right-wing allies have aggressively pushed discriminatory voter ID laws. For more on this and other stories, please do visit MediaMatters.org. This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm Bradley Herring. Fox News host Geraldo Rivera is the latest Republican to leverage a Fox News platform into a possible run for political office.
Here
he is during an appearance on Fox and Friends.
Yeah, you spoke about being in the Senate, and you created quite a firestorm yesterday on your radio show when you said, you know what, I am seriously giving thought to running as a Republican in my home state of New Jersey.
Look at that, you've already got your stump speech down. I've got a question for you. If you do run for Senate, though, you can't be on TV or the radio.
Well, if you do run, you got to come back and catch to make your official announcement.
Well, I'll be here every Friday until such time as it's no longer legal.
And if that wasn't enough, Fox News Latino ran a column entitled Geraldo Rivera, If I Were Senator Rivera from New Jersey. The column gave Geraldo the opportunity to show how he plans to use his media platform to benefit his candidacy. For more on this and other stories, please do visit MediaMatters.org.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
All right, Nicole Sandler back here at RadioOrNot.com.
Oh, let me.
Oh, no, 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 no. Hold on, hold on, hold on. I hope I blacked out his phone number there. I know Jason's expecting me. Let's try that one more time. La, 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 la. If not, we'll just call his cell. Because, yeah, I know he's expecting the call. Oh, I was going to play him some...
Hello?
Hey, Jason, I was going to play you some intro music here.
Okay.
For you. Can you hear this? Hold on 1 second. It's going to come in. See if you recognize it. I didn't cue in far enough. Okay, you recognize it?
Is it the Specials?
No, close. No, not even close. It was actually XTC.
Oh, of course.
Living Through Another Cue. But,
yes.
Anyway, I
throw me back to the 80s.
Played that in your honor.
Well,
it might
you.
Have even been the 70s, actually.
Oh, wow. So it's the first album.
Yeah, I think so. So anyway, Jason Leopold back in good old Los Angeles. Just returned. I'm putting up a picture now. I love on our Ustream feed here, which is just so awesome. Jason Leopold standing in front of the Camp Justice sign, Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, wearing a Black Flag T-shirt. There's something awesome about that.
Yeah, I figured the Black Flag T-shirt would more or less. Say it all.
Yeah. So,
it really speaks for me, put it that way.
I hear you. Okay. So, there's so many questions, but I guess we start with how was it?
It was a surreal experience. I mean, I really don't know how else to, you know, just describe it. I mean, it was surreal. I mean, I'm still even now trying to, just absorb the fact that I spent, you know, a week in Guantanamo. You know, I was there to cover the 9/11 trial, the pre-trial hearings for Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and, you know, his four co-defendants who are charged with, 3,000 counts of murder for the planning of the 9/11 attacks.
Right.
And so, you know, when I got to Guantanamo, let me just say that, you know, we started out leaving from Andrews Air Force Base flying over to Guantanamo. And you get to Guantanamo, you get to the airport, then you have to take a ferry, about a 20-minute ferry ride, over to, you know, the island where everything is. And so it was just strange, you know, doing that because, Guantanamo has become so synonymous with the detention facility, with the fact that we're holding these prisoners there, that's certainly all, that's all you know. That's all you think
that's
about.
That's all
right?
I knew, right? Guantanamo Bay is the prison there. That's all
right,
I knew about
it. You know, Guantanamo is actually a huge, huge island, and it's a naval base, and with everything that pertains to the prisoners that are being held is just a sliver of this massive naval base. So it really sort of put it in perspective for me in terms of really understanding how big Guantanamo is. I think the strangest thing, Nicole, is that because it's so big, because this is such a huge island, people have lives there. There's they go about their daily routine, and they have this prison in their backyard.
Amazing. I mean,
that's what's so surreal about it. I mean, think about it, you know, as if you're in your own town. That, you know, you have your McDonald's, you have your Subway sandwich, because that's what's over at Guantanamo. You have your football field, you know, so you're going about your business. But around the corner, literally around the corner from you, Nicole, there is a prison. And this is where people have been held indefinitely, you know, for the past 12 years, the past 11 years. So that is and that is exactly what it's like at Guantanamo, because you have, McDonald's, the Subway, you have an elementary school there, and people go about their lives, and literally around the corner is this prison facility. And then where I was staying, you know, you have this high security, legal complex that they put together specifically for Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the four others. So you're trying to take this all in, and try to understand, what's happening here, and it's just it's stunning, really.
Right. Now, you sent out, and I love this one. I've got a picture of you that I'm putting up of you standing in front of just giant shelves of albums, record albums, and you said there was a bunch of radio stations there.
Yeah, there's actually three radio stations on the dial. But they all come from one.
Okay. Well, that's
one hub.
Well, that's what it's like here too.
Yeah,
you know, it's consolidation.
It's called Radio Gitmo.
Oh, and
wow. Radio Gitmo. It's a they have three different stations. One's a hard rock station. Another is a hip hop station. And then they have I think they switch it off on the channel of. Pop, top 40, whatever's on Billboard.
Uh-huh.
And then they have a talk station. And, we took a tour of this radio station, and in the room that I'm standing in, they have this stunning, impressive collection, Nicole, of vinyl. And this is not just like vinyl that we used to go buy, over at our local record store, Tower Records. This is, this is vinyl specifically pressed for, Armed Forces Radio. And it's. I was holding a couple like Lou Reed albums, and you could see on the label how this is like specifically for them. So that was kind of a cool trip, to see this radio station.
Right.
But it's so. I'm at all while all this is going on, I'm trying to keep this in perspective. And what I mean by that is that, what's happening on that island, at that prison facility right now, what happened there years ago that no one has ever really been held accountable for. So you try to keep that in perspective And because it's, again, it really is a small little city, if you will. That's what it feels like. It really feels like a small town. And it was just strange that this, detention facility is there.
Right. Now, but Jason,
it's completely off limits. I should say that we're, we're not allowed to go anywhere near it. We're constantly, we have escorts, so it's not like we can really, really, start roaming around over to that side.
Over to where the prison is?
Correct.
Right. So you're on the, basically, it's a U.S. military base in Guantanamo Bay, but it is part of Cuba. Now, you keep saying it's an island. It's not its own island. It's actually on the island of Cuba, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah. No, this is part of Cuba. I mean, the history of Guantanamo, you go back to 1898, when it was leased to, I believe that's the date, or I believe that's the year, when it was leased. There's a long history about Guantanamo and about how that happened and about, the fact that, Cuba sees it as as an occupation. They haven't recognized the lease. I think they only cashed one check.
Uh-huh.
But yes, no, it's part of Cuba. In fact, when you go to the fence line, right, which separates, the Cuban side from the side that we're on. I mean, there's snipers there. That's their whole job. Their entire day's work is just literally just to stand to guard that fence line. And the same with, the Cubans on the other side. So. It was really intense, just the sort of visit and being, physically there at Guantanamo.
Right.
Of course, I should say that, we don't get to see, or we didn't get to see any of the camps. That was off limits. So I didn't get to, to see that. I can't tell you,
mm-hmm.
What life was like there. In fact, during the segue for a moment to, the hearing
right.
that took place at, during the course of the week, the attorneys who are representing, the defense attorneys who are representing, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the four others, they argue that, they too really don't get to see what, life is like for their clients in the high-value detention camp where they're held. So they want to spend 48 hours, at this facility. My
right.
point in saying this is that, it's so blocked off. I mean, it's so, it's not anything that we were able to really sort of see and understand. So the part of Guantanamo that we saw, was the part where, people are going about their daily routine and lives and, we stayed in a Camp Justice, which is, tents were set up, six reporters to a tent. We all shared a shower.
Wow.
And then every day went to, this high security courthouse to cover these hearings, and then walked over to the Media Operations Center, and banged out our stories.
Wow. So, okay. So if you're just joining us, Jason Leopold is with us. He is just back at home in Los Angeles from a visit to Guantanamo Bay. So not only didn't you get to see the prison camp, you were kept far away from that, but you also didn't get to go on into Cuba to check out what's happening there because, there was a Fidel Castro sighting.
Yes, I heard. I think it was, he was voting, right?
Yeah?
Yeah. excuse me. No, we did not get to go there. I mean, it was really, let me just say that the Joint Task Force Guantanamo, the public affairs folks that were, escorting us, many of them literally just arrived there. They were there for about a month serving their, their 9-month deployment. They were very nice. I mean, mm-hmm. they were pleasant and they're nice to be around. But it was off limits. They have their orders. We can ask them questions, but it's not as if they're gonna. You can just drive over to, the detention camp, or actually leave Guantanamo alone. because, as I said, you know, the entire, you know, the entire island, you know, where we were standing. I mean, it's a naval base, so it's not as if you could say, oh, you know, I want to visit Guantanimo today.
Right, exactly. So,
you can't have vacation there.
Sure, like I live 90 miles away. I'm here in South Florida, but we can't go there because it's not open to the public. Right, okay.
Yeah,
so, all right, so that's the backstory. Now, you were there to cover, it was a pre-trial hearing as part of the, you know, the military tribunal that's going to go on for these charged with the 9/11 murders. Robert Hill in New York City asked me to ask you if you saw any actual kangaroos there.
You know, if they would have hopped out, it wouldn't have been a surprise because it was, you know, on day one, you know, the kangaroo court or the kangaroo reared its head. You know, when we arrived there early on Sunday, the media, and there's about 20 reporters there, we were brought into, you know, one of the rooms there, and the chief prosecutor, his name is Brigadier General Mark Martins. You know, he said for those who were there for the first time covering this, you know, he impressed upon the media. He said, "Look, I urge you to withhold judgment about the process, about the military commission's process." Then Monday rolls around, the next day, and court begins at 9 a.m. And let me just say, you know, watching Khalid Sheikh Mohammed walk into the courtroom along with the four others, that was significant. And here's why, Nicole, because, you know, I realized that as I was watching this man, you know, walk into this courtroom, we haven't seen anything. We've only seen a couple of pictures of him over the past, you know, 11 years.
Right.
So it really felt significant and important just to sit there in the gallery to watch him walk into this into this courtroom. It felt significant in that, you know, it also made me sort of think about the fact that, you know, this man and these four others, you know, they're accused of these, these heinous acts. And it just made me, you know, think about the fact that they are being sort of held up as responsible for all of the, you know, changes we've seen to policies, all the new policies that have been put in place over the past 11 years. And they just, you know, they didn't have any superpowers. You know, they were just these frail-looking men. And that sort of made me think about it. Just a citizen, not as a, you know, the reporter, that, you know, they must realize that they've won to some extent.
Yeah.
So, you know, getting back, I'm sorry to, you know, to digress like that, getting back to, you know, the start of court on Monday after, you know, the chief prosecutor says withhold judgment, during the course of, you know, the proceedings, suddenly the audio feed goes out, and we start hearing this this white noise, and on the judge's dais there is a red flashing light. It looks like a siren. It's not making any noise,
right.
But that's what it looks like. And so, you know, just to again to try to explain this, we are all sitting in a gallery. When I say we, journalists, human rights organizations, and families of 9/11 victims.
Okay.
The gallery is separated by soundproof glass.
Mm-hmm.
So even though we can see the judge, the audio feed that we're, or what we're hearing is delayed by 40 seconds. So we're sort of forced to watch everything on a monitor. Okay.
Right.
And so during the course of these, you know, of this day, they start talking about, or attorney for Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the judge start talking about an exhibit that, or we believe it had to do with, you know, Khalid Sheikh Mohammed's detention at a CIA black site. As soon as the attorney said the word secret, suddenly the audio feed was cut, the video feed, you know, went black shortly thereafter, a siren flashes, and we were all wondering, geez, what happened? You know, what did he say that caused that to happen? Because, you know, the reason it's on a delay is in the event that there is a classified information we'll still have. So they come back after 3 minutes, okay, and the judge says, well, you know, let me just say that the 40-second delay was implemented, was enacted, and I didn't do it, and my court security officer didn't do it,
right?
And nobody knows who did it.
Wow.
How did this happen? And the, you know, the defense attorney is saying, who's monitoring these proceedings? Who's listening to this? What just happened here? And that was, you know, the sort of example of that, you know, the kangaroo court that, you know, your listener just spoke about. And it really, you know, for me, it really, all I needed to do was just report it. Was just simply reported. I think it spoke for itself.
Oh, yeah. And in fact, from here, watching your tweets and some of the other journalists who were there as well, it seemed like the issue over who was censoring and who was triggering, you know, this delay or triggering the censor seemed to take up the entire time you were there. Was that ever?
That was
it.
That was it. And, wow. You know, they were unable to get to any of these legal motions that they were dealing with because this was, you know, front and center. This was center stage. No one knew, who was responsible for this, or at least on the first day. No one knew who was responsible for cutting the audio feed. And the judge, the fact that the judge, Nicole, did not have any idea of what was going on to his courtroom was it spoke volumes about, you know, the integrity of this process.
Sure.
And, you know, it was revealed, you know, later on in the week that what they refer to as an OCA, okay, OCA, Original Classification Authority. Apparently, you know, those who can monitor these proceedings also include Original Classification Authority. That's basically, you know, the agency that had originally classified the material in question that was being discussed. In this case, although it was not said during the proceedings and the prosecutor did not answer my question, the Original Classification Authority here would have been the CIA. If in fact we're talking about, you know, what triggered the kill switch was the discussion centering on this, you know, black site prison. So that would have been the Original Classification Authority, but nobody will reveal the identity of the secret center of the secret censor, you know, which still remains secret.
Wow. So we
and
still don't know.
That really took up the week of hearings. They could not. They really were unable to get to any of the other, you know, motions that they need to deal with because the defense was saying, "Look, we don't know who is monitoring our discussions with our clients." In fact, you know, on the last day, on Thursday, the defense. Team filed an emergency motion saying, hey, look, these proceedings need to be put on hold indefinitely until we can find out who's listening to our communications.
Wow.
So that's
and that was it.
Courtroom.
So you were there to cover this pre-trial hearing to take care of a lot of stuff, and this is it. It was just because the sound was cut during the first few minutes of the hearing, and that's all they dealt with the whole time you were there.
That was pretty much all they dealt with. I mean, there were a couple of sort of abstract legal motions that were dealt with, but nothing really of substance.
Right. Well, except for the attorneys putting forth a request that they wanted to spend 48 hours under the same conditions where their clients were being kept.
That was something that came up. They did discuss that, and they basically wanted to, you know, more or less, you know, walk in the shoes of their clients and how that would, you know, they were sort of explaining, you know, why that would be important in terms of just, you know, understanding what conditions they live under. And so that was left unresolved. I mean, the government is basically saying, look, you know, we can accommodate you maybe for a couple of hours, But once you get into, you know, 48 hours, you know, security is going to be, it's going to be difficult to set that up. You know, we're not sure where you would sleep,
right.
You know, how we would handle this. So, you know, they're going back and forth, but it's really, really slow, Nicole. I mean, this is, you know, keep in mind that it's been 10 years since KSM was captured.
Right.
Okay. He was arraigned last May. May. You know, it's a year ago. And we're still dealing with these, you know, with these abstract legal motions. In fact, you know, the defense doesn't even have, the government hasn't even, you know, shared classified material as part of the discovery process with the defense because they're still going back and forth over a memorandum of understanding and, you know, in language that, you know, is not agreed upon or is at issue within this. So it's moving, you know, at a snail's pace. I mean, this is really slow. But
right.
then you see, you know, from a news perspective, as you know, from where I sit, what happened this week with the revelation that there is a third-party censor, an invisible hand at play.
Right. That even the judge doesn't know who it is. That's pretty,
right.
that's wild.
Yeah. And so that, you know, that became a gift, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And that was a gift to the defense. And the gift in the sense that the publicity, the bad publicity that these military commissions have, that's the gift that, you know, that the defense was given because,
right.
you know, they're trying to show that the integrity and legitimacy of these proceedings are trying to attack that.
Right. Now, and Jason, the other part of it is, look, you were there. You were one of 20 or so journalists, you know.
Yes.
Look, why so few? And I got to say, if not for you and a couple other people that I follow on Twitter, I wouldn't have known this was going on.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
nobody in the mainstream or corporate media, which are usually interchangeable, is talking about it. And I asked Alan Ratner, who runs the talk radio news service, because they do a live report here every morning. And she said, we were offered to go. She said, I won't cover it. It's kangaroo court. I won't give them any time. So it's kind of interesting that that's her reaction. You know, her brother, Michael Ratner, is I think the founder, the president emeritus of the Center for Constitutional
yeah,
Rights.
Yeah.
So
I know Michael very well.
Sure.
And
that's
they
Alan's
usually
brother.
Have representatives there.
Right.
You know, that was something, I mean, let me just say, Nicole, that in addition to all of this, you know, the 9/11 victims, or rather, families of 9/11 victims are there and they're chosen by lottery and they get to attend the proceedings. And you know, we met with them on Sunday, and it was really emotional. Let me just tell you. I mean, it's they start telling you the stories, and it's sad. But they were saying, they said, look, you know, we wanted to be here, but they too wondered, where is everyone? Why isn't anyone covering this? Where's the media? And you know, there's also a facility, or rather, a place where reporters and observers can watch it as well, in Fort Meade, Maryland. So they do play, you know, they do have it on closed circuit television there. But you're right. There is not much coverage of it. And after spending the week there, I can understand why, because of how, you know, because of the fact that that what they're dealing with in terms of the pretrial hearings is, you know, it's very complicated. You
mm-hmm.
know, the legal technicalities of everything doesn't really make for a great news story all the time.
Right.
In fact, we were really fortunate from a news standpoint to sort of get that. This week with regard to, you know, this secret censor. But, you know, the families, or at least one, you know, they, by the way, these were all parents who lost their children.
Oh, God.
So it was really emotional. I mean, it was terribly sad, and it just, you know, was a reminder of, you know, how people really were, impacted by all of this, but one woman who was there, you know, who lost her son, you know, she said, "Look, this I had to come all the way to Guantanamo for this. She believed that this should be in federal court, that it should be on U.S. soil. And, you know, she was very, very critical. Very critical of the fact that, you know, she had to travel, you know, from White Plains, New York, all the way to Westchester. I mean, excuse me, all the way to Guantanamo from Westchester County in New York, you know, to attend this. And so they were quite upset. And then during the, as the week rolled on, I think that they, you know, sort of understood, perhaps that, geez, you know, maybe this should be, you know, on U.S. soil, you know, those who may, who are disagreeing and understanding why, you know, there is a lack of coverage. It's not easy to get to Guantanamo, Nicole. You know, for me, you know, I'm coming from Los Angeles. I had to, you know, head on a plane to Washington from, you know, from Andrews Air Force Base to, you know, to Guantanamo. You take a ferry. I mean, this was a real long trip.
Right. I was hoping you were going to fly through Miami so we could at least sit and, you know, have a cup of coffee or something. But I guess there are no direct
flights.
Yeah, they
have flights. I mean, Andrews Air Force Base, when you're covering the commissions, that's, you know, that's the route.
Wow.
But it's not easy, you know. So it's and then, like I said, you know, they have it at Fort Meade. But this is you understand also that, you know, part of it is that they're keeping it completely out of, you know. I think that there are probably folks who are saying, good, you know, I'm glad that nobody's really covering this. Let's just leave it aside because they don't know what they're doing.
Exactly. Well, it sounds that way.
They're putting together these military commissions. It's a mix of, you know, state and federal and military courts martial laws that they're sort of pulling from, putting it into a pot, mixing it together, and trying to figure it all out. There's no legal precedent for this, so they really don't know what they're doing. And I do think that, you know, again, my opinion, that if it were sort of broadcast where everyone can see it, if you were able to watch this on C-SPAN, oh, wow, could you imagine, Nicole, if you were to watch this on C-SPAN, you know, last week and you saw this issue about the Secret Center, it would certainly...
It would certainly
make an impression, I think, on the public at large and be a huge embarrassment, you know, to the government.
You. Right. So, Jason, let me ask you a couple other questions. One, you were there. That was Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and the others, did they only came in on the first day? Because
they
only
came in on the first day, and that is something that, you know, the judge sort of made it clear to them that, look, when your case comes up, you know, when we return to court on that first day, you've got to be here. You've got to be here present, and you've got to, you know, be in the courtroom. If you choose to, you know, not attend after that, okay. You know, that's fine. You've got to sign a waiver and verbally say that you don't want to be there. So they were only there on Monday. But, you know, because of the issues with this, you know, secret censor and some other sort of smaller details that they had to deal with regard to, you know, classified material, there we lost a day. There was no session on Wednesday.
Right.
So on Tuesday, KSM and the others, they protested. You know, or rather, they boycotted.
Right.
You know, the hearings. They didn't show up at all.
All right. So all right. Now I know, Jason, at truthout.org, you've done a series of articles on the other Abu Zubaydah, on his brother who had been sort of harassed and targeted by the feds.
Have another one coming out probably at the end of the month, which is finally after receiving thousands of pages of FBI documents.
Okay, so now, I know you tweeted something that while you were there, you hoped to get him to sign something, or...
Oh, yes, well, that was sort of a joke. So,
oh, okay.
You know, as you know, Nicole, I file many, many Freedom of Information.
Yes, you do, right?
And so one of a couple of Freedom of Information Act requests that I filed in the past pertaining to certain things, you know, regarding his detention, things that he wrote... The FBI writes back to me and says that if I can get Abu Zubaydah to sign a waiver, a Privacy Act waiver, sure, they'll turn it over to me. So I was sort of like tongue-in-cheek joking that, oh, look, I'll be at Guantanamo. Maybe I can get, you know, Abu Zubaydah to, you know, to sign a waiver, a Privacy Act form. It's sort of ridiculous. I mean, you know, when the FBI responding to me saying that, well, if you can get Abu Zubaydah to sign a, you know, to sign this, sure, we'll turn
right.
it over.
I
they
see.
Know that I'm not going to be able to do that.
Right. In fact, you couldn't. So. Get, you can get anywhere near these people other than see them the first day they came in. Through,
exactly.
through a, you know, a soundproof, bulletproof kind of every kind of security glass there is.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, the, you know, prior, a day before, you know, proceedings began, we were given a little tour of the back of the courthouse, well, of the courthouse in general, but also we, you know, we saw where, you know, the small rooms at, cells at, you know, KSM and the others are brought into the, you know, the metal detectors and the search procedures. It's incredible. I mean, it was an experience that I think that, I'm really glad that I was there, you know, because as I mentioned to you, it was so important. Nobody has seen anything about, you know, KSM and the others.
Right.
In fact, you know, I was there with the, incredibly talented, you know, courtroom artist, Janet Hamlin. You know, there's no photographers that are, you know, that are obviously allowed. So that's it. Those are the only images
wow.
that we, you know, that we see. And it felt important to sort of, you know, bear witness to this and at least see it in person. I never would have been able to, you know, report about these proceedings in the way that I did unless I was there.
Sure. And now at least you have that image, the pictures, you know, to put things in perspective when you hear reports as sketchy and as few and far between as they might be coming out of, you know, things going forward. Would you go back?
Yes. In fact, I'm hoping to, I think it's in April that I will likely go back.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah. And I do hope that, you know, to get a, you know, a tour of the, of some of the, you know, of the camps. I mean, look, you know, everything is going to be sanitized. You know, I'll acknowledge that. And I think that that is clear that that's the case.
Of course.
But I'm also, you know, very well aware of how to sort of, you know, see through some things. You know, one of the things that they handed out to us. In fact, let me just read it to you, Nicole. You know, when we got there on Sunday, you know, Joint Task Force Guantanamo hands us a press kit, okay?
Uh-huh.
And Joint Task Force Guantanamo is about 1,800 people. So there's, you know, there's like 6,000, you know, if Guantanamo were to shut down, it would just be, you know, Joint Task Force Guantanamo. 6,000 other people would still be working at Guantanamo doing other
okay.
things.
Right.
So they hand us this press kit, and, you know, there's various items in this press kit, but, you know, one of the things in here is the Joint Task Force Guantanamo detainee programs. The social program includes communal living, recreation and sports, communal meals and prayers, family phone calls and mail. And it's basically a list to sort of, you know, go through and say, look how things are for the detainees now. It's not so bad. And I was commenting to one of the, you know, members of the Joint Task Force on the public affairs side, who was saying that, oh, look, you know, the detainees are prisoners. They take classes now and do artwork. And I said, look, I just want you to know that I will never, ever write the story that sort of talks about, you know, that I will never do that.
Right.
You know, the public relations disaster that you guys have, you know, that is Guantanamo, that what you're trying to deal with, that's not my, you know, my issue, my problem. You know, the fact remains that, that's why I said, Nicole, you know, keeping this in perspective, the fact remains is that you have 166, you know, men that are being held there, have been held there indefinitely. You have more than half that have already been cleared for release. You know, you have people who have, you know, who have died there under, you know, suspicious circumstances.
Yep.
So I'm not about to go and write a story of about, you know, prisoners now suddenly look, if things are okay.
They have a swimming pool. Right.
They can do these things. Yeah. Sorry.
Right. And the fact of the matter is, you've got a weird dichotomy there because you do have Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and other people who, yeah, might have been probably involved in planning the 9/11 attack. But then you've got these other people who were in the wrong place at the wrong time and sold by, you know, people's like, oh, the U.S. is paying us for bad guys. All right, here's the bad guy. And for whatever reason, no reason, in many cases, they're locked up in this torture center and kept there.
Yeah, yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
I mean,
exactly. And it's, you know, and I, as I said, it's that's what, you know, what's important to keep in perspective. Because, you know, during the course of my week, let me just be real here. You know, it wasn't as if I was living in this sort of depressed state. You know, I was with other reporters. Mm-hmm. We were going about our business. You know, we hung out till 3:30 in the morning one night. We told stories. You know, and then we'd look around at each other and say, this is unbelievable. You know, we're at Guantanamo. I mean, you know, we went to the officers' club one night, which is basically sort of a, you know, think of your local bar, right?
Right.
And it's for officers. And on the radio, or I shouldn't say on the radio, but on the, you know, the stereo system, they were playing LMFAO. You remember, you know, that band?
Yeah.
You know, real popular, you know, band. I think it's Body Rock. And it was just strange. Like, we looked at each other and said, this is so weird.
Surreal,
you know, there's
right?
this pop song that's like number one on the charts, and we're here at Guantanamo.
Yeah.
listening to this. It just, that was sort of the, you know, how surreal it was.
Right.
And, you know, when we, in fact, at this club, at this bar, there are a lot of Jamaicans and Filipinos who have lived at Guantanamo, who lived there for years and years and years and years, and, you know, who worked there. And I had asked this this man that he was from Jamaica. He's lived at Guantanamo for 18 years, just trying to earn some money. And I said to him, I said, what do you think about the fact that you have this prison, around the corner where these men are being held, you know, indefinitely? And he didn't really want to get into it, but he said, you know, Americans got to do what Americans got to do. And, you know, that's as far as he would go. But, you know, what's really amazing as well, Nicole, is that, you know, you start asking some people around about the military commissions.
Yeah.
Some of them didn't even know that it was happening.
Wow.
They weren't even aware that this was happening on the island, and they're there.
Yay.
So, you know, out of sight, out of mind for lots of people.
Right. You know, it's interesting, Jason, because last week, of course, we saw what was supposed to be a confirmation hearing for Chuck Hagel to be the new Secretary of Defense, and it turned into like a bullying session. And there was one part where, and I forget who it was. Oh, I think it was Ted Cruz, just berating him over and over again. You said that America is the bully of the world. I'm listening to this as I'm driving in the car, and I'm screaming back at the radio, we are! We are the fucking bully of the world! And so what? He can't say it? Personally, I'd rather have a Secretary of Defense who knows that we are and feels bad about it and like says that's not okay.
Yeah, no. I completely understand, and I think that is a legitimate statement, you know, to be that he made. You know, the problem will be, of course, is he going to backtrack on it? Is he going to try to explain it? There's no explaining it. I mean, it's clear cut. So, and as more time passes, particularly, you know, with this administration in office, it becomes clearer that that's kind of true, right? So it's just amazing what this new, I shouldn't even say new, what normal is now, Nicole, you know, and this is sort of normal.
Yeah. By the way, the other thing that's sort of normal, Jason, just to segue here, your daily shooting report, in case you were wondering what time it was going to come down, shooting reported at an Oklahoma intermediate high school, meaning it's ninth graders.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, now it used to be about every 10 days. Now it's a daily event, just so you know. And by the way, the standoff in Alabama with the guy who, boarded a school bus, shot the driver dead, took a five-year-old little boy, is today in its seventh day.
It's just,
yeah.
Unbelievable.
It's a crazy fucked up world. And, you know.
It really is. It's.
This was a suicide. Okay. School in Coweta, Oklahoma in lockdown after a student committed suicide in the bathroom. I hate to say it, but at least whoever it was didn't take anyone else down with him
right.
or her.
It's scary. Scary. It's been this way for a while, of course, but as a parent myself, you know, sending your kids to school is incredibly frightening these days.
It is.
You know, and I say that simply as just a, you know, as a parent.
Yeah,
so.
But, you know, I guess I bring this up, and we've got to go in a second. But, look, we don't necessarily have to worry about, you know, Islamic terrorists and Khalid Sheikh Mohammeds. We're doing it to ourselves.
Yeah, it's true.
So, Jason Leopold, so I'm guessing you've got, I know you had one story up at Truth Out while you were gone. I read part of it here on the air.
Yeah. I actually had a couple of stories out, you know, just sort of one on Thursday stating that the judge, I didn't even mention this and I apologize to your listeners, the judge ordered the government to suspend any outside or any third party sensor from activating that button.
Ooh.
So that was the order that the judge handed or handed down on.
And does the judge have that authority? That's the question. You know, we'll see, because if someone's back here, you know, in let's say John Brennan's office watching and deciding
exactly,
to do it, hello, he's going to say, sorry, judge, I make
right.
that call, not you. And forget
right.
about worrying about Chuck Hagel. We should be worrying about the confirmation of John Brennan to head up the CIA.
It's very true.
Yeah.
We should be. And then also questioning Dianne Feinstein for, you know, about that report that her committee put together on, you know, on torture and get it released.
Yay. More. We'll revisit this one. Jason Leopold, glad you're back home. Thank you so much. And
Thank you, Nicole.
I'll talk to you later.
I'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Right, bye-bye. Jason Leopold of truthout.org. All right. It's time for the news. And for that, we turn to our friends at the Talk Radio News Service. They're at talkradionews.com. Good morning. Who's on the line today?
Good morning. Victoria Jones here.
Hey, Victoria. So did you stay up late to watch the the Super Bowl?
I stayed as late as I could. There was a limit to how late I could stay, but I stayed through the blackout.
Yeah, the blackout was the fun part.
The blackout was exciting. I stayed through Beyonce, and I stayed through part of the second half, and then I realized with the 35 minutes, I knew it was going to go too late for me, so I just couldn't make it.
Yeah, I hear you. And I don't care regardless. So, I found the blackout kind of. Interesting. It added some fun to the proceedings, I guess.
Yes.
It was just weird, and it figures it was at the Superdome. And of course, I read at the start of the show some of the funniest tweets, a guy named Gary He tweeted, this would never have happened if the Superdome had a gun.
I saw tweets like that too,
which
I thought were fascinating.
Yeah.
There were some great tweets.
There were some
like
great
that,
tweets.
Yeah.
Well, of course, because, look, at least it made it, there's some excitement, something different. Because I guess it got better in the second half, but the first half was kind of a blowout.
Yeah, I think it would have stayed like that if there hadn't been the blackout.
Very
the
possible.
The momentum was
right?
broken.
Yes, it was. Right. Yeah. So, but for me, the best part of the Super Bowl are the commercials. I thought most of them were pretty but I loved the Clydesdale one, the Budweiser.
Oh, the horsey and the phone.
Gave me goosebumps.
I know, me too.
And what other? Oh, the Amy Poehler one was funny. She made it seemed to
funny.
Me like they just let her loose in a Best Buy and just shot and then edited it together because I don't think that was like scripted for her. I think she did that. I think it was funny.
So I thought that was good. The other one I did like, this was another animal one. I liked the Doritos one with the goat.
Oh, I didn't see that one.
Well, you've got to see it. Okay. Only a 30. It's very funny.
Okay.
But it's about a goat's revenge.
Okay. I will look at that.
Very funny. It's about a pissed off goat.
Okay. And Ellen must like that one. Because goats for the old goat.com.
I don't know if she watched the Super Bowl at all. I don't know if she knows what the Super Bowl is.
I see. But goats for the old goat.com. There's a tie in there.
She knows those kinds of
goats.
Yes,
I know. Okay. So, other than that, not much more news. You know, Beyonce, yeah, she doesn't do it for me.
I mean, you know, she was great. She was whatever that is. She was terrific. I am a rocker, you know, to
me too.
Nothing can compare with Prince. So
Bruce, you know, Springsteen. Sorry, that's my thing.
Prince was great, but to me,
Prince is always entertaining. The Two, though, you know, it wasn't the Who, it's the Two now, and they were kind of a letdown.
Yeah,
just saying.
Yeah,
okay, but there is
and that amazing 108-yard pass was pretty incredible.
I guess
it's pretty amazing. I mean, to me, as a non-football person, that's quite amazing.
Yes,
I can see that that's amazing.
Right.
But the rest of it is sort of
All right. In the news, guns in the news every day. Apparently, a kid in ninth grade committed suicide in the bathroom of a school in Oklahoma this morning. With a gun. Standoff in Alabama with that crazy guy who took the 5-year-old kid after killing the bus driver. Still going on. That's pretty sick. Now, what's the deal with this sniper guy? First of all, I worry about somebody who is, you know, in the armed forces and keeps track of how many kills he has. That's kind of creepy to me. But this American sniper guy who wrote about it in a book was at a gun range with somebody else, another former soldier. I guess the guy's mother asked this guy, Chris Kyle, to help her son because he was dealing with PTSD, and they go to the gun range and somebody kills them both.
Yeah, but the guy who supposedly had PTSD and whose mother had asked Chris Kyle to help the son, with PTSD turned the gun on Chris Kyle and on his friend and killed them both.
Oh, my God. Oh, that's the guy who did it. Oh, my God.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
That's the guy who did it. Yes, indeed.
Oh, my God.
Terrible.
I got it backwards. I thought he was one of the ones killed. Ay, ay, ay.
No, he did it.
Well, I'm sorry. Why do you go to a gun range with someone who you know is having, you know, problems? Not that I'm not faulting this guy, but ay, ay, ay. So today, President Obama's in Minnesota talking about guns.
Yes, he's in Minnesota talking about gun violence. He's in Minneapolis meeting with the Minneapolis Police Department, Special Operations Department, and he is going to be talking about what the White House is calling his comprehensive set of common sense ideas to reduce gun violence. He'll be giving remarks, he'll be meeting with community leaders, members of the community, as well as the police. And he's picked Minneapolis because they've taken a number of steps to reduce gun violence. So that's why he's picked that city.
Okay.
Now, it'll be interesting to see what he talks about, because when this is his first foray outside the Beltway to talk about his proposals, and when Vice President Biden went on his first trip outside the Beltway within the last couple of weeks, he went to Richmond, Virginia, and he talked extensively about the 23 executive orders and about everything. But what he didn't talk about was the assault weapons ban. That was the one thing he didn't talk about at all. So will the president talk about that, or will he focus much more on background checks and things like that, or will he mention support for the assault weapons ban, or has that become invisible now? I don't know. It'll be interesting to see.
I don't know either. We will, you know, coming up in the segment after this, Nicole Bell comes over from Crooks and Liars. She watches all those Sunday Talking Head shows, so we don't have to. And, you know, it looks like even, you know, some of the usual right-wing crazy suspects are saying enough already. Because Chris Wallace basically told Wayne LaPierre that he's an idiot. I was going to use a different word. You know, basically told him, like, enough already. Enough already. So, yeah, we'll get to some of that. I think people realize, now, what's sad is the American public realizes it. The NRA members realize it. It's just the NRA takes all this money from the gun industry, the manufacturers and retailers, and that's who they represent, not their members. And then they buy off the politicians who will not vote against what the NRA leadership wants. It's really sad.
Well, that certainly is, I think, the way so many people are starting to look at the NRA at this point. And I would say that Chris Wallace gave him a pretty hard time yesterday. I watched that and I tweeted extensively throughout that interview, and he gave him a very a pretty tough time.
Yeah, I was glad to see it. Good. Kudos to Chris Wallace. So now the guns are also going to be brought up in the Senate today. Is Dianne Feinstein introducing? I thought the bill that's being introduced today doesn't have anything about an assault weapons ban, right?
The guns will be not on the agenda today. The guns have been coming at it most likely on the agenda today. Guns are likely to come up as a bill early next month.
Okay, you're all muffled on me all of a sudden.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to get muffled on you. Guns are likely to come up as a bill by early next month. The Violence Against Women Act is on the docket today.
Okay, I see. Oh, good. So is anything going to happen with that?
Oh, I think so. I think there's strong momentum. Senator Patrick Leahy tweeted last week that they have 60 votes, what he called the magic number. So they've got the 55, plus they've got at least 5, if not 7, Republican votes for passage of it in the Senate.
Okay.
Of the Violence Against Women Act. So they believe they can get it through the Senate. So it's just a question of negotiations now with the House to be able to get a House bill through, is what they believe.
All right. Well, we'll see what happens. And finally, two things. Is Chuck Hagel going to be confirmed? Or did Grumpy Grampy, you know, beat him too hard?
Well, what people seem to be saying is that, yes, they think he is going to be confirmed, but he's coming out of this pretty bruised. He seems to have hung on to all his Democrats, which is interesting to me, but I don't think he gained any Republicans. He is going to be doing another round of Hill visits this week, going to meet senators on the Hill to try and garner more support, because I think he realizes he did badly. I mean, how he could not realize that, I don't know, because he did. So he's going to shore up support. And hope to try and gain some more Republicans to vote for him to get to 60, and to hope that nobody steps up and says they're going to filibuster. So far, nobody has actually said they're going to filibuster, and he's frankly very, very lucky.
Yeah, because, well, you know, I got to say, he didn't perform very well, but I thought, you know, they were just brutal to him, especially his old buddy, John McCain. Now, when is John Brennan's confirmation hearing? And I hope they're at least half as tough on him, because he actually deserves it.
That is on Thursday the 7th.
Oh, okay. This Thursday. Cool.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
You know, I hope somebody gets tough with him and asks him about drones and all his other, you know.
He is going to have quite a tough time. He will be asked about enhanced interrogation techniques or torture.
Good.
He will be asked about waterboarding. He will be asked about drones. He will be asked about cyber warfare. He's going to be asked about a lot of stuff, some of which may even go, we may not see, because it will have to go into closed hearings, but some of which we certainly will hear.
Okay. Well, good. I look forward to that one. And also, this just broke this morning. It seems that in the wake of Scott Brown announcing he's not going to run for John Kerry's Senate seat, Tag Romney now is saying he might run.
Yes, Tag Romney's thinking of running. Yes,
oh, God.
Tag,
oh, that's
is thinking
terrible.
Of running.
Tag, you're not it. Yeah.
Nice one.
Yeah. All right. On
and,
that note.
And finally,
yes.
Finally, they have confirmed that the skeleton that they found in Leicester, England, is Richard III.
I didn't know he was missing.
He has been missing since 1485.
Wow. And I also hear we now know he had scoliosis.
He did. So, because Shakespeare said he was a hunchback,
wow.
And he was.
Wow. Look
now,
at that.
Why is this significant to Nicole, who's not into kings?
Yes. Why? Why?
Because among the reforms that he brought in was the presumption of innocence for defendants.
Wow.
And the granting of bail.
Ooh, nice. A couple of things that we supposedly kept over here, except if you're, kept in Guantanamo Bay for undisclosed reasons.
Right, and I'm sure that he had various things, like that. But nevertheless, he brought those things into being. They did not exist until Richard III brought them in.
Huh.
He also brought in certain things to do with that you couldn't be taxed unless it was fair, all kinds of things to do with, all kinds of things protecting merchants, protecting native craftsmen against foreign merchants, all kinds of very interesting things.
Cool. Oh, that's good to know. And I'm glad they found him after all these years.
And he probably murdered his 12 and 9-year-old nephews.
Oh. Okay. Well, those kings.
Those
just
got to
say, I think it's the inbreeding. It happens with purebred dogs, too. When they inbreed too much, they get a little off.
I don't think they were inbreeding back then.
No?
I think it was, I think the inbreeding started earlier. No, I think it was the greed and ambition.
Ah. All right. All of it. All of it. Okay. All right. Well, thank you for that. Victoria Jones of the Talk Radio News Service. Find her at talkradionews.com and here. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
All right. Nicole Bell is coming up. Yes, Nicole Bell and the crew over at crooksandliars.com. They watch those Sunday Talking Head shows, so we don't have to. And I guess somebody was just like watching incredulously to the Fox News Sunday yesterday when Chris Wallace actually got hard, tough with Wayne LaPierre. We've got that coming up. So don't go away. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's Radio or Not.
From what I know, this is the largest decision we will be making as a state from a carbon pollution standpoint, certainly during my lifetime, and nothing comes even close to it.
Will Washington State ship dirty coal to China?
It looks like a tornado right near downtown Cartersville at this moment, slashing toward I-75.
Wacky winter weather strikes the southeast. Which kills more birds, wind turbines or house cats? ALEC pushes anti-science curriculum. Plus,
this will not be important for Qatar, but for all the region and elsewhere where they have the same climate as Qatar.
A green tech oasis in the desert.
All of those stories and more straight ahead. From BradBlog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
I mean, we don't have climate change coverage in America.
Hello, John Stewart. We're sitting right here. We can hear you. This is your Green News Report.
I'm gonna soak up the sun.
Okay, Desi Doyen, can you believe John Stewart would turn on us like that?
I know. It's as if he doesn't know we exist.
I know. All right. Well, we got some interesting weather news. A tornado in the middle of January down in Georgia?
Yeah, rare January tornadoes swept across the southeast on Wednesday.
This funnel is about to cross the interstate here in Adairsville. We've got debris now flying to the left and center of this system.
100 cars were overturned on the freeway in that storm. One person was killed in Georgia, and that breaks the record for the longest streak between tornado deaths in the United States, 220 days. And that's because of the drought gripping the Midwest. Dry conditions mean fewer storms. Fewer storms mean fewer tornadoes. And on the same day, Newark, New Jersey hit a record high temperature of 65. Groundhog Day is on Saturday. We'll see if Punxsutawney Phil gets it right this time. Last last year he failed to accurately predict the record warm winter. Imagine that.
Read the science, Punxsutawney Phil.
France is mandating energy conservation with a new law requiring all businesses and shops to turn off their interior lights overnight. Christmas lights and special events are exempted. Officials say it will reduce light pollution in the night sky across the country, and it will save the equivalent of the energy consumption of 750,000 households.
Not to mention completely unnecessary carbon in the atmosphere.
Which kills more birds? Wind turbines or house cats? Fox News steps on the cartoon rake again on its website, lamenting that the Obama administration has failed to prosecute wind farms for killing hundreds of birds. What Fox didn't mention was a new study published in Nature this week that confirms cats kill 5,000 times more birds than wind turbines in the U.S. That's over 2 billion birds a year killed by cats in the U.S. alone. No word yet on when Obama plans to lock up the killer kitties.
But I'm delighted to hear that suddenly Fox News is concerned about birds.
ALEC is infiltrating science education. The right-wing American Legislative Exchange Council, or ALEC for short, which is used by corporations to spread corporate-friendly copycat legislation in the states, now has model bills in three states that mandate teaching climate change denial in science class in public schools.
Oy.
Look out, Arizona, Colorado, and Oklahoma. You could be joining Tennessee, Texas, and Louisiana. ALEC is heading your way. A record fine for Chevron. California regulators have slapped a nearly $1 million fine on Chevron for their massive refinery fire in the Bay Area last August. That's a record for the state and the highest allowed under state law. Investigators found, quote, willful violations in Chevron's response before, during, and after the fire, and they found that Chevron disregarded corrosion on aging pipes at the 100-year-old refinery located in a residential neighborhood.
Wow, $1 million. That could take them minutes to recoup.
Chevron says it will appeal.
Of course they will.
A big decision ahead for Washington State's new governor and climate hawk, the former Senator Jay Inslee. He must now decide whether to approve construction of new coal export terminals to ship U.S. coal to China. Coal use has fallen in the United States due to the glut of cheap natural gas. So the U.S. coal industry has made up the difference by doubling its exports of coal to China in just the last year. The proposed export terminals would mean a lot of new revenue for the state, but Governor Inslee, in his first press conference, admitted the projects could bring a lot of future climate change impacts.
It is decades or centuries worth of coal. It doesn't matter where it's burned, it ends up in Puget Sound.
Finally, a fascinating new sustainability project in the Arabian Desert. The Sahara Forest Project is a pilot project bankrolled by the tiny Arab nation of Qatar, part of its pledge to use its vast oil wealth to transition to renewable energy. The Sahara Forest Project uses and combines for the first time all current sustainability technologies into one development in the desert. Check out the video at our website, greennews.bradblog.com.
Doesn't Qatar own Al Jazeera?
Yes, they do.
Didn't Al Jazeera just buy Al Gore's current TV?
Yes, they did.
There you go, shilling for Al Gore again. For more on that story and the ones we couldn't get to today, please check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. While you're there, please help us celebrate our 10th year of troublemaking and muckraking with a donation to the Brad Blog. We would certainly appreciate it. From bradblog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report.
I got cat class and I got cat style.
If retail jobs are our future, how can we make them good jobs? I'll tell you. Today on Hightower Radio, the powers that be say that the bulk of America's middle-class manufacturing jobs are gone and won't be coming back. High-tech jobs are being outsourced too, as are accountants, lawyers, and some other professional positions. So where does this leave us? Grasping at straws, the most abundant of which are retail jobs. But wait, those aren't jobs, they're jobettes. Part-time, poverty pay, no benefits, lousy schedules, little training, and no advancement opportunity. Most big retail chains treat their employees as nothing but a drain on profits, not an asset to invest in. Salespeople are typically paid only $10 an hour, clerks get only $9.70, and cashiers just $9. Worse, 94% of retailers define full-time work as only 30 hours a week. People can't make ends meet on that, and America can't have a healthy economy without a solid middle class. Yet 15 million people are in retail work now, and it's to be our second biggest source of new jobs for the next decade. Well, shrug the powers that be, the retail giants must compete on low prices, so they have no choice but to keep cutting corners on their workforce. As we say in Texas, bovine excrement. Look at Trader Joe's, where full-time jobs start at $40,000. Or at Costco, where employee retainment is a priority and 98% of managers are promoted from within. Low-price chains that invest directly in workers are reaping industry highs in performance, morale, customer satisfaction, and profits. Bad jobs are not a retail necessity, just a corporate choice. This is Jim Hightower saying, this week, a Retail Justice Alliance has been launched to push America's employers and policymakers to turn retail jobs into good jobs that spread a middle-class standard of living and rebuild our grassroots economy. Learn more at RetailJusticeAlliance.org.
Need an antidote to the progressive blues? Want some good news about how grassroots folks are rebelling against the corporate powers and winning? Well, here's an easy-to-swallow pill for you. The Hightower Lowdown. Hightower's monthly newsletter will give you the lowdown, even as it lifts you up. It's 4 pages a month, jam-packed with facts you can use, actions you can take, and Jim's own Texas humor, all for only $15 a year. To become a lowdowner, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
This Valentine's Day, give your special someone a beautiful Swarovski crystal heart made by women who have survived war in South Sudan. These stunning items are available in small, medium, and large sizes and come in crystal, red, pink, and other beautiful colors. And the best part? They're yours starting at just $25 plus shipping. To order yours today, go to goatsfortheoldgoat.com and click on shop. Again, that's goatsfortheoldgoat.com and click
on shop.
It's
time once again for Fools on the Hill with Nicole Bell on The Nicole Sandler Show.
All right. This is the time of week when we check in with Nicole Bell of Crooks and Liars. She watches those Sunday Talking Head shows, so we don't have to. And Nicole, based on the beginning of the write-up that you brought us this week, I've got a little something for you here.
I'm tired, sick, and tired of love.
You can sing along if you want.
I've had my fill of love. From below and above. Tired.
Just a couple more seconds.
Tired of being admired. Tired of love uninspired. Let's face it, I'm tired.
Okay, I know you're tired. You're tired of ridiculous beltway extremists. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
I am so tired. And actually, that's exactly the song that was running through my head when I was looking at the lineup, you know, when I got sent the lineups from the various TV shows.
Uh-huh.
And I went, oh. Because it is the same people over and over again, and they never give us anything new. And it's always these ridiculous obfuscations. There's never any real conversation happening. And even on a show like Chris Hayes, which I normally love,
yeah,
you know, he had Edward Conard, who was one of the partners at Bain Capital on, to go against Stiglitz. Like, there's no comparison of their concept of the economy, but yet they're on side by side.
Right.
You know, he also had one of Romney's economic advisors. And
why?
It's not that I don't... See, that's my thing.
Right.
I don't care about alternative voices. I think that that's a good thing. I think that, you know, my beliefs are strong enough and based enough on reality that I can handle listening to other points of view. But you know what? I want to hear my point of view being said instead of being taken up by people like Conard and what was her name? Karen something. You know, because they get all the airtime. Carly Fiorino gets all the airtime.
I know, right.
Ralph Reed gets all the airtime. When do we get to hear people like me, who have, by the way, been right all the way, all along.
Exactly. I mean, that's why it was so heartening to see Paul Krugman on Morning Joke one morning last week. And, you know, he took them all apart. I mean, it was great to hear him take apart Ed Rendell, who, you know, they put up there as, you know, as a liberal Democrat, who is anything but. And for Paul Krugman to put him in his place, like, have we been living in the same country for the last 6 years? I mean, it was perfect. So I hear you. And, you know, Chris Hayes has always done well for the last year or so, really a remarkable job of, you know, verbalizing, articulating our side. But then, I mean, I didn't even watch much of it this weekend because it seemed like he was overly concerned with getting the other side on. Well, you know what? We hear from them all the time.
Right. They get their shot. They get their shot on the big three networks. They get their shot on CNN. They get their shot mm-hmm. on all of the other shows. So let me have one show, just one show, where there's actual right. discussion with adults,
exactly.
not these extremist children.
Right. And that's why I usually love his show, because it is. They're real adult conversations. But like I said, This weekend, I just wasn't there. I watched Law & Order reruns. So I'm glad to know you watched, so we didn't have to. And, of course, I never go to the fake news channel. And you watch Fox News Sunday. But even Chris Wallace is tired. And, boy, he was all over Wayne LaPierre. I'm going to first play the first part of the interview, which really isn't what you wrote about, but just listen to what Wayne LaPierre, his line of bullshit about semi-automatic guns.
I want to talk to you about this whole question of rights. The Heller case is the case, the big victory for the NRA, in which the court affirmed the Second Amendment means what it says. But here's what Justice Scalia wrote in the majority opinion. Let's put it up on the screen. The Second Amendment conferred an individual right to keep and bear arms. Of course, the right was not unlimited. Not unlimited. Scalia talks in his majority decision about what kinds of weapons people can buy, who can buy them, where they can be carried. The right is not unlimited, Mr. LaPierre.
And we have all kinds of reasonable laws right here. The NRA supports it. If they'd enforce them in Chicago, it'd cut crime. But for the most basic right is to protect yourself. And the American public wants to be able, semi-automatic technology's been around for 100 years. If you limit the American public's access to semi-automatic technology, you limit their ability to survive.
What?
But if someone's invading your house, I mean, you shouldn't say you should only have 5 or 6 shots. You ought to have what you need to protect yourself, a woman should, not what some politician thinks is reasonable.
Oh, God. First of all, I mean, I'm surprised that nobody reached out and smacked him after that. Because it's offensive what he says. But, so then Chris Wallace goes on and says, well, you know, the NRA, you guys released this ad. And you went right after the Obama kids. Here's a little bit of the ad, and then they're back and forth after that.
Are the president's kids more important than yours? Then why is he skeptical about putting armed security in our schools when his kids are protected by armed guards at their school?
Mr. LaPierre, do you regret putting up that ad?
The point of that ad was this. It wasn't picking on the president's kids. The president's
it mentions
the
them.
The president's kids are safe, and we're all thankful for it. The point of that
they also
ad,
face a threat that most children do not face.
Tell that to the people in Newtown. Tell that to the people.
You really think that the president's children are the same kind of target as every school child in America?
I think
that's ridiculous, and you know it, sir.
Unfortunately, I think there are parents.
That's ridiculous, and you know it, sir. I don't need to hear more of Wayne LaPierre's spewing, but it went on like that. Chris Wallace kept calling him on his bullshit.
Yeah, I think that you're looking at Chris Wallace going, I'm tired.
Yes.
This is absurd. We are at this level. I mean, and there's no good excuse. There's absolutely nothing that the NRA can do that rationalizes or justifies their actions. Now, they were the ones who were pushing for background checks before. And
yep.
Now, what was that, during the Clinton administration?
Mm-hmm.
Or Reagan? I can't remember.
I don't know.
You know, they were the ones pushing for it. Now, all of a sudden, that is tyranny? Come on. That's ridiculous.
It is ridiculous. And you know, what is finally becoming clear is that, well, and we'll hear it in the next clip, is that the NRA, you know, they keep touting their members and how, first of all, their membership grew by 275,000 people after the Newtown shootings. I like to point out, yeah, so what, their membership is what, 4 million? And there are 300 and some odd million people in America? To me, that's a tiny minority. Why do we give them so much power? But the fact is, the majority of those members support reasonable regulations. And right. And again, rather than listen to Wayne LaPierre spew his bullshit, I'd rather listen to Mark Kelly, who was on with Chris Wallace before LaPierre, and Chris Wallace actually let him speak. Here's a little bit of that.
As you know, Wayne LaPierre is going to be on right after the break in the next segment. Man to man, what do you want to say to him?
Well, you know, certainly he's going to say that background checks don't work. But that is not true. I mean, he's going to tell you that in a couple minutes. Since 1999, 1.7 million people were prevented from getting a firearm because they had a criminal record or a history of mental illness. We stopped those people from getting a gun. Now we've got to make sure they don't have a second option to get the gun. And that's getting a gun from a private seller or the gun show loophole without having a background check. We need to close that loophole. So I hope Mr. LaPierre can think about what would his members want. You know, 74% of NRA members think it is a very reasonable thing to do to have a background check before buying a gun. So what I would tell Mr. LaPierre is, you know, I hope he would listen to his membership because members of the NRA tend to be very reasonable on this issue.
Captain Kelly, thank you. Thank you for joining us, and we wish you and your wife the very best, sir.
Wow. See, wow. You know, normally on this on this show, it's the opposite, or it seems to be anyway.
Well, and in fairness, and you know how much it just hurts my stomach to say that about Rupert Murdoch, he doesn't understand the American gun culture. I mean, he has been notoriously tweeting, "What the hell is wrong with you people? This is not that big a deal, you know. Assault rifles aren't necessary." He himself is very much for sane gun safety regulations. He doesn't want to take guns away from everybody. He doesn't want to, you know, he doesn't want to take all the guns out. But he's from Australia. They've dealt with this already because they're adults, unlike the children here in the U.S., and they've gotten it down so there's very little gun violence. See, that should be our goal. You know, and the same logic that says, you know, you can't prevent every single incident of gun violence, so there's no point in even enacting this, is the same faulty logic that says, well, you can't prevent every car death by mandating people wear seatbelts.
Right, or even more, you can't prevent, you know, every bank robbery, so why have a law making bank robbery illegal? You know,
right.
you can't mandate that criminals are going to obey the law, so why have a law? I mean, that's what he's saying. You know, criminals aren't going to obey the law, so why bother making laws?
So that's the kind of childish logic that we're operating under.
I know.
And that's the voice. Again, Nicole, this is the part that drives me crazy. This is the voice that gets out on TV.
Yeah, I know.
That is the person who's gotten booked every single week since Newtown. It's not Mark Kelly. Thank God he was on. Thank God Chris Wallace gave him a chance to speak. It's Wayne LaPierre who gets to speak instead.
I agree. Well, at least now he's being talked back to by an unlikely voice. So maybe some of those dwindling Fox viewers are listening. I mean, the story broke last week that the Fox ratings are at their lowest point in 12 years. You know, maybe the American psyche is finally shifting. You know, maybe people are finally waking up. I hope.
I don't think there's any question about that. I think that what you're seeing is that most Americans are far more sane and far more mature than what passes for media in the U.S.
Right.
Because you know, not only is Fox not doing well, Rush Limbaugh is basically being subsidized by, you know, right-wing think tanks to stay on the air because he's losing money.
Well, actually being subsidized by Clear Channel because he's under contract and he's got a ridiculous $50 million a year contract. No wonder, you know, that they keep firing people left and right because they have to pay Rush Limbaugh's fat salary.
Right. Well, and you know who's helping is Dick Armey and, right. and Karl Rove and people like that. They're throwing some money there because it helps them, with, you know, keep the media airways polluted with this kind of conservative talk. But it's turning off people. I don't. People aren't willing to go to this level of craziness. And unfortunately, the media just hasn't caught up with it.
Yep. No, I hear you. And it's really sad. And hopefully it won't be too much longer before those voices completely die out. And maybe Clear Channel, Bain, hello, will just say, we got to cut our losses. Sorry, you're not bringing in the money anymore. You got to go. Maybe, you know, because for Rush Limbaugh's salary, they could hire, 300 people.
Right.
It's sickening. All right. So Paul Krugman does make these appearances, but on ABC. So he was on This Week, and he calls Carly Fiorina and others on the panel for their nonsense and talks about this gun culture where we live in.
What really strikes me, and I don't know how this plays, what will happen. What strikes me is we've actually gotten a glimpse into the mindset, though, of the pro-gun people, and we've seen certainly Wayne LaPierre and some of these others. It's bizarre. They have this vision that we're living in a Mad Max movie, and that nothing can be done about it, that America cannot manage unless everybody's prepared to shoot intruders, that the idea that we have police forces that provide public safety is somehow totally impractical, despite the fact that, that is in fact the way we live. So I think that the terms of the debate have shifted. Now the craziness of the extreme pro-gun lobby has been revealed, and that has got to move the debate and got to move the legislation to at least some degree.
But I love the analogy of they're living in a Mad Max movie.
And that's exactly it. You listen to these people, you listen to Gail Trotter's testimony,
oh
you're like, what the hell kind of life do you live? What neighborhood do you live in that you need an assault rifle to protect yourself from intruders? I mean, I don't understand that. And that, I've lived in urban centers before. I've lived in, places where you drive through other neighborhoods and go, ooh, maybe I should lock my door. I have never once felt the need to have an assault rifle.
Nor I. And yes, I've lived in New York City. I've lived in Los Angeles. I've lived in Miami. I mean, hello. Never. Not only did I not want an assault rifle, I don't want a gun in my house. I don't want a gun near my house. I got to tell you, I'm reading this book, we've talked about this. My daughter has ADHD, and she's a bit oppositional. And, it's a difficult, some days are more difficult than others. And so somebody recommended this book to me. It's a great book if you have teenagers with a horrible title. It's called Yes, Your Teen is Crazy. But forget the title. But it is a really, really good book. And there's a section in it. I should have brought it in here. Maybe I'll share some of it tomorrow about guns in the home. And this guy said, get the guns out of your house, because more often than not, there's a gun in the house. You say you have it, for safety. It's going to be used to hurt somebody. Get the gun out of your house. And he it was so good. I'm like reading this going, yeah. if most people, more guns that are in the house for safety are used inappropriately than not.
Right. You're 8 times more likely to die from a gunshot
if you have a gun in your house mm-hmm.
than if you don't. And it's even scarier when you look at teens, because the number actually becomes higher. The number of teens who attempt suicide by gun if there's a gun in the house is, I think it's 11. They are 11 times more likely if there's a gun in the house to attempt and succeed in committing suicide.
Wow. Well, just this morning, a shooting in an Oklahoma intermediate school, like a ninth grade school, a kid brought a gun, I'm guessing it's a he, but I don't know for sure, and killed himself in the bathroom. So somehow I'm guessing the gun was probably the parents. Now, I have no proof. I don't know for sure. But, it's a suspicion.
Yeah, well, I have to tell you, that happened to me when I was in high school. There was a kid who was sort of an outcast and a nerd, and probably got tormented a lot more than I was aware of.
Mm-hmm.
And he came to school and he killed himself in front of his class.
Ay, ay, ay.
And thank God I wasn't in that class, because I'd probably be traumatized to this day from that.
Right.
But You know, that does happen. And that's one of the reasons why people want to be able to ask, is there a gun in your home?
Right.
When they're doing, and that's something the NRA is fighting.
Yes, they are. And, you know, the fact is, and that's something they did here in Florida. Like Rick Scott said, no, the pediatrician can't ask you if you have a gun in the house. Well, it's part of the Affordable Care Act that they can.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's a very good reason for it. There are substantial scientific studies that show that single thing can lead to, but there's a causal relationship between a gun in the home and violence in the home.
Mm-hmm. I hear you. And again, this book, I just brought it up on the Kindle on this, but I can't find the exact page. So I'll try to pull out a couple of passages for tomorrow, because it made me go, well, yeah, nothing I didn't think of before, but yeah, you know, I'm glad it's in this book. You know, when if you've got a troubled teenager, especially in the house, get the guns out of there.
Right.
They're not
gonna make
you safer.
And honestly, my kids are Montessori kids,
mm-hmm.
And so I've done a lot of research into the Montessori thing, and Maria Montessori called adolescence the second infancy.
Uh-huh.
Because your brain literally sort of shuts down for a while.
Yeah.
Because there's so much other physical development.
Yep.
Happening.
Yep.
That it's not processing information.
Right.
Correctly. And between the hormones and your brain truly not processing information correctly, that's a very, very dangerous setup for all sorts of problems, even if you don't have a troubled child. Even
right.
If you think your child is normal, that's a very, very dangerous setup, because you don't know how things are affecting them. They may not be telling you.
Exactly.
Everything.
They don't. And that's what the title, that's what's behind that title, is he's using parents' vernacular. But the fact of the matter is, kids, teenagers' brains are not developed fully. It doesn't happen until, you know, they're still developing during those teen years. It's not fully developed till like 20 to 25. And a lot of the reasoning isn't there, and they're impulsive, and they've got so much going on. And you know, they are a little irrational, you know? So, yeah.
Yeah.
Get the guns out of the house. All right. Moving right along, Candy Crowley, who did so well in the debate and actually corrected Mitt Romney yesterday, she has Elaine Chao on the show, and she lets Elaine Chao, even goads her into sort of disparaging Obama and the administration without ever identifying the fact that Elaine Chao, who was in the George W. Bush administration as what was she, secretary of, she was in
labor,
the,
or
yeah,
human services. Yeah, I can't remember.
She was in Bush's cabinet, George W. Bush's cabinet. What we don't know is that she's Mrs. Mitch McConnell. Yeah, they never tell you that.
Does the president, I mean, he says it's really the Republicans that are standing in the way of what he'd like to do in the economy.
I don't know how he can say that when he had control of the three, you know, of both the houses in the legislative branch. He had the control over the White House.
But he doesn't
from
now. From 2009
you're talking about now. To
2010. Yeah.
He was able to get sweeping changes through to our economy, which actually, including, for example, Obamacare and also you know, Dodd-Frank, which are actually having a hampering effect.
Dodd-Frank on regulation
the,
of businesses.
Yeah. They're having a dampening effect.
They are?
On job creation.
They are?
I'm actually rather surprised that in his State of the Union, in his inaugural address, that there was not a more magnanimous spirit shown, that there was not more of a graciousness to focus on reaching out to the other side, to work together. He uses the words, but if you look at the agenda, it's very much a far-left agenda item. And if you look at the numbers report of this past Friday, I don't know how anybody can say that that was a good report.
And
so
yet,
I think the president has to focus on job creation. He cannot do everything at one time. And clearly, job creation is far, far less than what we expect.
Okay. All right.
Can I just smack her now?
Yeah.
And just be done with
right.
it? Because everything she said was just a load of crap.
And her name is Mrs. Mitch McConnell. Well, she, I don't know if that's her name, but she is married to Mitch McConnell. Yeah, so...
Right, the guy who said, my job number one is to make sure that President Obama is a one-term president.
Yes.
And then she has the gonads, because I'm going to say it right now,
Go ahead.
To actually go on the air and say, he didn't reach across the aisle.
Right. Mr. I want to compromise and be Mr. Bipartisan. That's all he did. You know, that's what gets me. How anyone can say that he doesn't reach across the aisle. If there's anything he does too much, it's, right. it's you know, bow down to the Republicans. Well, I want everyone to like me.
Right. And yeah, you know what? We don't have enough jobs. And guess whose fault that is?
Obama.
That's the fault of the Republicans who demanded that the stimulus have one-third tax cut,
mm-hmm.
but the job creators who did not turn around and get jobs, and then they drastically slashed federal spending, and all of those school teachers and all those policemen and all of those other, you know, employees, government employees, public sector employees, lost their jobs.
Yep.
So, yeah, you know what?
I know.
You're right. We should have a better job. But if we had let the adults have the conversation, if we had let the adults make the decisions instead of playing these childish games, you know what? We'd be in a much better spot.
Yeah, yes, we would. By the way, it's not only ABC that didn't or CNN that didn't disclose who someone's married to. Got to say, for those who, you know, continuously yell at the TV when Andrea Mitchell is on, Mrs. Alan Greenspan. Just saying.
Yes.
Mrs. Yes. Greenspan. Hello. So, yeah. Okay. And then there's one more. Of course, yesterday was the Super Bowl. I'm so sorry, Nicole. I know you live in near San Francisco.
It was a terrible.
It was a tough night for you guys.
Gut-clenching. I mean, right up until the last quarter, it was...
Well,
it's hard.
Well, the first half. I mean, I was in and out just and saw they were getting killed. I'm thinking that somebody there, you know, broke a fuse to take away the momentum of Baltimore.
I want to say Beyonce secretly, as I understand.
Yeah, can I ask? Do you get the Beyonce thing?
I don't.
Yeah.
I don't. I actually, my girls love her.
Do they?
My girls
Allison
are very excited
too.
About the whole Single Ladies song.
But
I don't get it.
Yeah. You know, she looked good. Okay. Yeah.
And I guess the Destiny's Child thing was a very big deal, even though I think that was the worst kept secret for the Super Bowl. But
I thought those other two girls were her sisters, but I guess not. I thought they were family, so to speak, but I guess not.
No.
Oh,
yeah.
I thought they were sisters. Okay. Shows what I know about, you know, pop music. I'm a rock and roller. Yeah. Okay. But I do know that there's this huge controversy over football, and especially the injuries, you know, that players are suffering, like the long term effects of constantly being hit like that, and the concussions, and you know, recently Junior Seau, I know, was big with the San Diego Chargers when I lived in San Diego. When I heard, you know, whatever, less than a year ago, when he killed himself. You know, it's like, okay, he shot himself in the stomach so that they could examine his brain. And we're seeing this over and over again. I got to say, last weekend, Chris Hayes did a great segment on this and had on one former player who is now suffering from dementia or something, and the widow of another player who had killed himself as well so that his brain could be examined.
Right.
And so yesterday on Face the Nation, Bob Schieffer is talking to the commissioner, the NFL commissioner, Roger Goodall, who, listen to this, incredulously still won't admit that there's some kind of link there.
Some widows of some NFL players have asked me to ask you, do you now acknowledge that there is a link between the game and these concussions that people have been getting,
Bob,
and some of these brain injuries?
That's why we're investing in the research, so that we can answer the questions. What is the link? What causes... some of the injuries that our players are still dealing with. And we take those issues very seriously. So we're putting $30 million into the National Institutes of Health. This morning we announced an initiative with General Electric to put more research into how do these injuries occur, how do we prevent them, and how do we diagnose them with some leading companies. And this is something we think is going to be very important.
I mean, of course, for years the league would not acknowledge, really, that there was a connection. You now acknowledge that there is connection.
Well, Bob, again, we're going to let the medical individuals make those points. We're going to give them the money, advance that science. In the meantime, we have to do everything we can to advance the game and make sure it's safe.
Wow. Wow.
You know, this is one of those things, it just really breaks my heart. When you see a game, and really, this is a kid's game,
mm-hmm.
where adult men will fall all over themselves and excuse all sorts of terrible things just for the sake of keeping this game intact. You know, they excuse rapes, they excuse, yep. you know, child molestation in the case of Joe Paterno.
Yep.
They'll do all of these things just to keep playing football.
Yep.
And, you know, it's not only Junior Seau and Jovan Belcher who killed his girlfriend, his
yep.
baby mama, before
yep.
he killed himself.
Yep.
It's people like Alex Karras. Do you remember,
yes.
you
oh,
know, we
sure.
played the clip from Blazing Saddles?
Yep. yep.
Alex Karras died last year
yeah.
from dementia. Had suffered
Alzheimer's.
From dementia for years.
Wow.
And he is one of the first in the class action suit against the NFL.
Wow.
And I think that's one of the reasons why Roger Goodall was hedging and humming, because
right.
he doesn't want to put himself into a liability issue. Because football players are suing because
uh-huh.
they haven't been protected. And because
no.
they have created this culture where you were supposed to go out and kill your opponent. You were supposed to not just tackle him.
Mm-hmm.
You were supposed to dogpile him, and you would get bonuses for that.
Yeah. No,
and,
I know.
And now we're looking at what, you know, we're looking at what's happened. And,
what?
You know, I can't, my grandmother died of Alzheimer's disease, which is not, obviously my grandmother did not play football,
mm-hmm.
but, you know, I have seen what happens to a family who's dealing with long-term brain injury, a brain disability like that, and it is just horrible. And
yep.
for them to protect the game, for
yep.
them to sit there and say, you know, we're doing what we can, no, you know what? Stop this culture of violence. Stop giving people bonuses for attacking the opponents.
Right, but
doing, you know.
Yeah, you know, David just walked in here and he said, well, you know, Goodell represents the owners. It's almost like Wayne LaPierre representing the gun industry, right?
Right.
Not the members. But so the same with this guy, he represents the owners and of course, can't admit that there's any link there. But, you know, there was a South Park episode. Not too long ago, that they tackled this issue, so to speak. And I forget what they called it, ethical ball or something. And they all wore tinfoil hats and they, you know, they played with balloons or something. And, you know, they couldn't hit each other. And you know, obviously took it to the absurd. But there was an interview with Terry Bradshaw who said if he had young boys, he would not let them play football.
Right, and neither would, and President Obama famously said
Sorry.
The same thing this week. And, you know, I have girls.
Yep.
They're not into contact sports, thank God.
Yep.
But I would, you know, if I had sons, I wouldn't let them play football.
No, nor would I.
I would be going, baseball, Patty, baseball.
Yep. And Allison is playing softball again. You know, we live in Florida, so they just started the practice for the spring softball league, and she's really
yep.
getting into it. But, yeah, I mean, look, I wouldn't. So here we go. You know, there are some who say, as someone, I forget who it was, maybe it was Dave Zirin or somebody, said, you know, that they think that football may not be around too much longer. Forget it. Money is all that's important, and football is such a big money maker. There's no way football is going to disappear, and I don't think they're going to make it a whole lot safer.
No, I don't, and that is unfortunate because that is exactly the kind of culture where people think, you know, guns are the response to
mm-hmm.
disagreeing with
right.
people.
Right.
That kind of whole violent culture is really what we need to all collectively move away from.
Yeah.
And I get it. Football's fun, you know, metaphor for war, ground acquisition, the whole bit. I get that. But there's got to be a way to do it so that you're minimizing the risk of head injury.
Right. I mean, look, last night I was, you know, watching and I saw one of the players, like, push another player like pushed him out of bounds. And I said to Dave, is he allowed to do that? And he started laughing. He's like, yeah, they're allowed to do pretty much anything except, you know, stick out your foot and trip someone.
Right.
Yeah. So, yeah, jump on them, you know, hit them hard. I mean, maybe they can change some of the rules and get better equipment, but then it's not going to be as exciting. So who knows? Who knows?
Yeah, I don't care. It's the same with wrestling. It's the same with hockey.
Yeah.
I don't care.
Boxing.
If it's less exciting.
Look at Muhammad Ali. Right. Look at Muhammad Ali. I'm sorry. I won't watch boxing. I think it's just a barbaric sport. And, you know, if you're wondering why Muhammad Ali is the way he is, probably because of all those blows to the head.
No. There's no, absolutely no question. His is part of a traumatic brain injury. And we know that this stuff happens. I mean, you know, I've told you before, my husband was in a catastrophic car accident, almost died 15 years ago. And when that happened, because his head went, you know, into the window, they were like, you need to watch him from now on.
Wow.
Because when you see these kind of brain injuries, their personalities can change. And they can become violent. And
yep.
They become irrational. And you need to keep an eye and see if this is something that's going to happen because of the trauma his brain took. You know, if my husband in a single car accident had that happen,
mm-hmm.
what are these people who play
over
10, 15
again.
Years in the NFL and are taking hits week after week after
yeah.
week doing?
I hear you. No, I look, something's got to give. But look, if we can't, you know, get guns out of the hands of people who shouldn't have them, money is more powerful than we are. You know, just parents, don't let your babies grow up to play football.
Well, you know,
baseball.
My one consolation, Nicole, is that I think that the tide is turning. I think that the election showed that money isn't more important than we are, that when
mm-hmm.
we are, you know, moved, we can actually change those things. And
yeah.
we can rise above big money interests. And, you know, you look at NRA members, who you would think would be all up in arms about, you know, tyranny, because that's what Wayne LaPierre represents. And they're saying, no, you know what? Go ahead, do background checks. We're good with that. That's
yep.
a good idea.
Mm-hmm. No, I that's what he should say. Instead, but, you know, look, I'm glad he's not, because instead he's alienating everybody. On that note, Nicole Bell, we're just about out of time, and I'm tired. I'll talk to you next week. Thanks,
right,
Nicole. Find our crooks and liars. We'll leave you with Madeline Kahn from Blazing Saddles. All right, we'll do it again tomorrow. Radio or not. Bye, everyone.
Morning, noon, and night, it's drink and dancing. Some quick romancing. And then a shower. Stage door Johnny's constantly surround me. They always hound me with one request. Who can satisfy their lustful habit? I'm not a rabbit. I need some rest. I'm tired, sick, and tired of love. I've had my fill of love from below. And above, tired of being admired, tired of love uninspired. Let's face it, I'm tired. I've been with thousands of men again and again. They promise the moon. Always coming and going and coming, and always too soon. Bye, girls. I'm tired.